On the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the palace in front of the king's hall. The king was sitting on his royal throne in the hall facing the entrance. When he saw Queen Esther standing in the court, he was pleased with her and held out to her the gold scepter that was in his hand. So Esther approached and touched the tip of the scepter. Then the king asked, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? Even up to half of the kingdom, it will be given to you." Queen Esther replied, "If it pleases the king, let the king together with Haman come today to a banquet I have prepared for them. Bring Haman at once, so that we may do what Esther asked." The king said. So the king and Haman went to the banquet Esther had prepared. As they were drinking wine, the king asked Esther again, "What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? Even up to half of the kingdom, it will be given to you." Esther replied, "My petition and my request is this. If the king regards me with favor, and if it pleases the king to grant my petition and fulfill my request, let the king and Haman come tomorrow to the banquet I will prepare for them. Then I will answer the king's question." Haman went out that day happy and in high spirits. But when he saw Mordecai at the king's gate and observed he neither rose nor showed fear in his presence, he was filled with rage against Mordecai. Nevertheless, Haman restrained himself and went home. Calling together his friends and his wife, Zeresh, Haman boasted to them about his vast wealth, his many sons, and all the ways the king had honored him and how he had elevated him above the other nobles and officials. "And that's not all," Haman added. "I'm the only person Queen Esther invited to accompany the king to the banquet she gave. And she has invited me along with the king tomorrow. But all this gives me no satisfaction as long as I see that Jew, Mordecai, sitting at the king's gate." His wife, Zeresh, and all his friends said to him, "I have a pole set up, reaching to a height of 50 cubits, and ask the king in the morning to have Mordecai impaled on it. Then, go with the king to the banquet and enjoy yourself." This suggestion delighted Haman, and he had the pole set up. That night, the king could not sleep, so he ordered the book of the Chronicles, the record of his reign, to be brought in and read to him. It was found recorded there that Mordecai had exposed Bigthana and Teresh, two of the king's officers who guarded the doorway, who had conspired to assassinate King Xerxes. "What honor and recognition has Mordecai received for this?" the king asked. "Nothing has been done for him," his attendants answered. The king said, "Who is in the court?" Now, Haman had just entered the outer court of the palace to speak to the king about impaling Mordecai on the pole he had set up for him. His attendants answered, "Haman is standing in the court. Bring him in," the king ordered. When Haman entered, the king asked him, "What should be done for the man the king delights to honor?" Now, Haman thought to himself, "Who is there that the king would rather honor than me?" So he answered the king, "For the man the king delights to honor, have them bring a royal robe the king has worn, and a horse the king has ridden, one with a royal crest placed on his head. Then, let the robe and horse be entrusted to one of the king's most noble prince. Let them robe the man the king delights to honor, and lead him on the horse through the city streets, proclaiming before him, 'This is what is done for the man the king delights to honor.' Go at once," the king commanded Haman. "Get the robe and the horse and do just as you have suggested. For Mordecai, the Jew, who sits at the king's gate, do not neglect anything you have recommended." So Haman got the robe and the horse. He robed Mordecai and led him on horseback through the city streets, proclaiming before him, "This is what is done for the man the king delights to honor." Afterwards, Mordecai returned to the king's gate, but Haman rushed home with his head covered in grief.